Death Store is an action game developed by British indie studio Assez-Neuve, of which one of the members, David Fenn, is also the talented composer. Released in July 2021, it made a strong impression, especially thanks to its interesting, even moving artistic direction, which brings freshness to a rather conventional type of game. Death Store is a Zelda-like with an almost isometric perspective, combining, as expected, combat and puzzles with a touch of platforming. But not too much. We play a little crow working as a small hand for the Reaping Commission, thus having to call back many lost souls to death. Death Store follows Titan Souls, a boss rush based on the idea of single life. Armed with a single arrow that they could however get back, the playable character had only 1 HP without being able to heal, on equal terms with the bosses, all of whom had a weak point that killed them instantly, as long as you managed to reach said weak point, which was not necessarily easy. Death Door takes some artistic elements and especially some bosses from Titan Souls, however it has a more explicit story, certainly related to Titan Souls, and a more complete gameplay, highlighting a flawless artistic direction which I even described just now as moving. By a clever mix of genres, it manages to combine humor, a fragile facade for the character's melancholy, with a devastating dynamism leading the little crow into ever more epic fights. We play as a charming little crow, obviously new to the Reaping Commission headquarters. Some souls are a bit slow to reach the world of the dead, and it's up to us to get them back, or rather fight them, which we do right away with a demonic forest spirit. As we celebrate our first victory, a silhouette opens a portal and steals our soul. This is uncharitable. We go through the door they came through and are transported to the Lost Cemetery where, after many confrontations and another boss, an old crow explains why he stole our soul, the forest spirits, and gives us a new mission, open Death's Door. His designated soul, the one that was assigned to him years ago, the one he has to reap, is behind this door. In order to be opened, it needs to be given soul energy, a lot of it. The demonic forest spirit's energy was not enough, but it might be possible by collecting 3 giant souls, those of 3 people who have stayed alive a little, sorry, way too much time. A witch, a frog, and a yeti. We don't really have a choice. The soul we were assigned, the forest spirit's soul, has disappeared behind this door since the grey crow took it earlier. We are mortal until we bring it back to the headquarters. So we are dragged unwillingly into the story of the Grey Crow. The little playable crow is probably a young recruit, a trainee. He is significantly smaller than the other crows, who gets caught up in a story without intending to at all. We see him get off the bus for what looks like his first day on the job, or at least his first big mission, a giant soul, an opportunity to explain the rules of the universe without it feeling too contrived and to make plausible his first encounter with the Lord of Doors, during which the latter makes fun of his lack of knowledge of the Reaping Commission's bureaucracy. Full of innocence, at his first victory against the demonic forest spirits, he jumps for joy, and after a few surprises in front of a chest that swallows him whole, the famous avarice that we face 4 times during the game, we see him stretch before the 3rd fight. That's also him we see at his desk on the menu screen, visibly bored before going back to work. His animation, jerky when it comes to his head movements, giving him a skeptical look that works well with the perplexity that some characters or situations can arouse, or even his walk, becomes much more fluid when rolling and when the character gets up after getting hit, so the whole thing is very balanced. He also has an animation when he's on the edge of a platform and is about to fall into the water. Watch out for the feathers. But if some details can make him endearing, this little playable crow doesn't speak. He's one of the few silent characters in the game, although the sound design of the NPCs is rather limited, which reinforces his apparent innocence and attentive ear to the worries of all this little world, from a head turned into a pot to Death himself locked behind Death's door. Pretty annoying. As a result, it's mostly the non-playable characters who are highlighted. We don't identify much with the playable character, he's quite sweet actually, but we rather sympathize with the NPCs like the crow himself. The important thing in this game is Death. It's the characters who are directly confronted with it. So this is their emotions, their suffering, their excesses as well that Death's Door emphasizes. The crow is, however, carefully characterized. In particular, he is no executioner, just a reaper, and he keeps, like a small vessel, his weapon in his back. He just has to make sure everything runs smoothly in the cycle of life and death of souls. Well, at least at first. If the basic sword is simple in its design, as the fledgling becomes aware that his mission is getting tougher than intended, he is seen actually holding his weapons, whether they look like wings or a good old hammer. This is also visible if you look at the cover art. If it shows a confrontation, this isn't between the crow and the non-player characters, this is between all the characters and the player. Almost all of them are present, which makes the whole drawing very imposing, with a slight low angle that accentuates the size of some of the characters. The different layers of NPCs, each one seemingly towering over the previous layer, and especially in the center there's the crow Chandler, sitting at his desk, who seems threatened by the skull on the neck of the grey crow. It makes a nice curve. Few smiles in this odd bestiary, but some characters are more innocent. They really seem to look at us, even the playable character, who is not in opposition with the others, as if to warn us, to challenge us, to look at us a bit defiantly. Will you be up to the task? They seem to be asking us, especially Grandma and Pothead, one hand on his hip. This erases the hierarchy between the characters, as they have the same role here, facing the player. Finally, if it's not a character to which we necessarily get attached, although he can be touching by the reactions related to his anthropomorphization, this is not the point anyway, this is not about making him a strong character, even if he is a bit more than the other birds, he is the four-tailed crow. Yet the developers have managed to give some humanity to this little crow, to all the crows actually, thanks to the camp in the High Sea Heights, the camp of the free crows led by Vaga, whom we first meet in our workplace, with the little crows asleep in cocoons. What's the point of being eternal if it means being a reaper? The little crow is not supposed to stay outside the Hall of Doors for long. Indeed, he is mortal as soon as he passes through any of the doors leading him to the desired destination. He ages as long as he has not killed the right soul. His gameplay is therefore focused on attack, with weapons and magic, but no protection. Ripping souls is supposed to be fairly easy, the cross swords should be enough. However, he can dodge and heal. If you dodge with an elegant roll, healing is a bit more complicated. It requires two things, a seed and a pot to make it bloom, after which the flower is consumed and the crow is completely healed. He's back to his maximum health, which is rather generous, but you still need a seed and a pot. They are often close, but not next to each other. Some minimal exploration is therefore necessary. You can thus have a seed, but no pot, or the opposite, and in this case you cannot do anything. We are therefore in an alternation between opposite states regarding our health. It's better to wait until we have very little health to heal ourselves, rather than healing regularly, thus being at full health most of the time. There are, however, quite a few seeds, 50 in the whole game, some almost redundant, symbolic. Once again, the game is generous without being too simple. Effective during exploration, healing is indeed impossible during bosses and waves of enemies, except in very rare cases. Concerning the attack, we start with a glowing sword, but the game gives us another weapon in each area, favoring speed or strength. The attack works by combo. The basic sword allows you to hit 3 times, after which you have to wait a little. This goes up to 6 for the light weapon. Mobility is necessary, but the roll itself has a decent recovery time that prevents us from attacking right after dodging. This is usual. The recovery is quite long at the beginning, but it can be improved since there are stats to upgrade. However, there is no stamina tied to your movements or your weapon. You can roll. There are too many enemies for a stamina bar linked to dodging not to make you destroy the controller. You must be able to dodge at any time. This also balances the crow's speed, which is rather slow when he walks. There's no sprint, you have to roll. And roll. And roll. Weapons also have a charge attack as well as a roll plus attack combo, more powerful, and most of all they are spells, magic. The arrow spell with which you start the game, then fire, bombs, and the grappling hook, combining platforming and attack in its improved version. Spells are not endlessly usable, it wouldn't make sense, but are managed by a spell bar that fills up when you hit an enemy or objects from the scenery. Crates, mushrooms, ice crystals, but these objects are not always available, especially in mandatory fights. If you run out of magic, you must first confront the enemy in hand-to-hand combat to then be able to move away a little. The game is well balanced. These four spells can be upgraded by facing the associated Silent Servant. So the gameplay is rather oriented on attack and swift dodging, risks to take while keeping a cool head, the crow being without real defense, no shield, no parry, no healing during unavoidable fights, as shown by the animation when he gets hit. He falls heavily on his back, the music is muffled, and we see a nice blood stain on the ground. The UI is very simple because there is no life bar for the enemies, which allows to keep a good readability in fights that generally involve many enemies to face simultaneously. Most of the gameplay consists in fighting waves of enemies with sometimes mobs that spawn indefinitely as long as the main enemy is not dead, as in this room in the manor where small mobs spawn repeatedly as long as the knight with the tongue is still there. That's a lot of people. However, this confrontation is not totally blind, thanks to the appearance of a slightly fluorescent corruption on the enemies, which then seem to crack, including the bosses. It's an effective clue for the mini-bosses and bosses, the more basic mobs only require a few hits to be killed anyway. Also, the simplicity of the UI is offset by a color change of the health points as they decrease, as well as a vignette effect around the screen when we have only 1 HP left. No need to look at the life bar to understand that you have to be careful. It didn't happen to me in Death Door, but sometimes in Hollow Knight I get this thing during exploration phases. I don't pay attention to my life bar because I know the game and tend to play faster each time, then suddenly I see the vignette effect on the screen. I know I have to heal. The choice of waves of enemies is quite clever in that it easily evokes a list of enemies to kill, like a list of souls to collect. To symbolize the immortality of the little playable crow, we don't see him using his wings. He can't fly during the whole adventure, he can only hover when falling. The weight of platforming in the gameplay is, however, relatively limited, but it is used to increase the difficulty of the game from one dungeon to another. If in the cemetery or the estate of the Urn Witch, there is no danger for the little crow, from the mansion's basement or later in the Frog King's domain, you can fall into the water, and crows apparently do not like water, or even in the void, especially in the old watchtowers where some parts are done on ice or with lasers. Or both. This is a good way to increase the difficulty beyond the mere change of enemies, which are also not very varied. The player must be more precise in their movements. The boss's speed also increases with Betty and her infuriating rolls, and the very last boss has some pure platforming phases which test our reflexes with a grappling hook. The game is thus centered on combat, the crow's goal being to find specific souls and fight them, and puzzles, with a bit of platforming sometimes. Hence the possible comparison to Zelda and the comment I have read a few times that the game was not revolutionary. However, this is not necessarily essential. My favorite game, Hollow Knight, we know that, is not necessarily revolutionary either, and it doesn't matter. And most of all, Death Door is a bit different from Zelda in some aspects of its gameplay, like the absence of protection and objects, and has, as one of its strong points, a remarkable artistic direction. Death Door takes some elements from one of Acid Nerve's previous games, Titan Souls, a boss rush in which, armed with a bow and only one arrow, the playable character faces, logically, titans. All of them have a weak point that kills them on the spot, as long as you manage to reach it. The playable character finds themselves very weak in front of each of these bosses, since they have only one HP. Each hit, laser, projectile or poison cloud is fatal. Death Door features several bosses adapted from Titan Souls, notably the demonic forest spirits, Avarice and Betty. We can recognize the color palette and some of her patterns, as well as the atmosphere of the confrontation with the Grey Crow, which is the same as that of the fight against Truth in Titan Souls. We can note that several Truth symbols are visible on some structures of the Death Door universe. Some mechanics are similar, like rolling for dodging, the only protection we have in both cases, and the fact that we start Death Door with, just like the human challenging the Titans, a bow that is useful for some puzzles present in both games. Finally, graphically, death or injury in Death Door is symbolized by a bloodstain on the ground for the human as for the Little Reaper. However, the graphic style differs since Titan Souls is a pixel art game, and in particular, the playable character walks through large empty areas. Paradoxically, they have more interaction with their environment than the Little Crow in that they can swim, cling to climbing plants, but this is only useful to find the lair of a new Titan. Most of all, there is no dialogue at all. Titan Souls is a game in which we have no verbal interaction with anyone. The only accessible plot is that of a human challenging titans one after the other. Death Door is, in this aspect, much more explicit in the story it tells and the way it does it, notably its humor is very assertive. Titan Soul manages to spread humor in its boss battles through the design and patterns of some bosses, or through details like the music that stops instantly when you're hit, but its overall intention is perhaps more enigmatic. Even if Death Door presents a clever mix of genres, it is directly accessible. The humor of Death Door is multifaceted. The names of the characters can be puns like the Steadhorn spoonerism, or more descriptive expressions, pothead, even paronyms, Bob the Bard or Chandler the Handler. There are also some humorous features in the UI itself, such as the broken panel whose text appears broken, Brutus' slower dialogue text, the Frocking's endless title, and the death screen. The anthropomorphism of the characters, including the playable character in spite of his silence, makes them endearing but also funny, as when the running gag, the multiple confrontations with Avarice, makes the reactions of the Little Reaper evolve, swallowed without care in a scene with a cartoonish sound design. I will come back to this scene in the last part of the video. More globally, the graphic style shows humor in the general appearance of places and characters and in many details as well, like the logs under Pothead's pothead, the urned portraits inside the manor, the roots at the back of the tombstone that serves as Steadhorn's head, Frocking's armor that's too small or Bob's bagpipe that breathes about as much as Bob herself. The intention of a game can be different from its graphic style. Tunic is made of cute characters, even the enemies, the spiders are perfectly scary although they look like adorable cuddly toys, and the soldiers are quite cute, it has to be said. Yet very quickly one understands that the game's intention and story goes beyond the small playable character. The vixen seems to be confronted with a story of great magnitude, violent, if only in the animation in the first cutscene when the older vixen hits on the shield that imprisons her. The burying ground in particular is accessible almost from the beginning, and it is not a pleasant sight. But as you might expect, there will be a video on Tunic. In Death Door, however, the humor we find in the graphic style is also definitely there in the game by the other elements mentioned, but this humor, as I will detail later, has a protective function. It is often a facade to the character's sadness. The story of all these crows and all these souls is not that funny. Death Door is a 3D game with the perspective very close to an isometric perspective. It is not, however, an actual one, simply the camera is far enough away from the character as if he was being observed, which is perhaps the case, in fact. After his victory against the first boss, the little crow finds himself in front of an intriguing character, the Lord of Doors, to bring them in person the giant soul he has just recovered. If the Lord quickly cuts through our meeting, we learn that they have an unobstructed view of the different biomes and, in particular, Death Door at the end of the Lost Cemetery. Their sigh is a bit too heavy for the Lord of Doors to be totally innocent in this soul business. The game has some cinematographic aspects. Besides the fairly frequent zoom changes as well as camera rotations when you reach secret places, there is a nice work on the depth of field, and the game uses a few effects that are a bit spectacular, almost comical by their slight excess. Death, in case you didn't really get it, and at the end of each fight, the last blow is highlighted by a slight zoom in as well as a slow motion. This is similar to another effect in the game. Each time you hit an enemy, the game stops for a few frames, as well as the timer. Everything stops to accentuate the strength of the hit, while the image shakes slightly. The three dungeons have the same structure. First, we explore an area outside the dungeon, facing waves of enemies before arriving in the dungeon itself. It's always a closed place, a manor, stone rooms, and a castle. In this one, we have to open a door, feeding on souls. We have to free four souls, small dead birds, protected again by waves of enemies. Once the door is opened, we find ourselves face to face, feathers to tongue, with a chest, avarice, which swallows us whole and makes us go through waves of enemies, once again. This is where we get a new spell, fire, bomb, or grapple, opening the door to the second part of the dungeon. For example, after getting the fire spell, we open the door to Grandma's Furnace. The exploration of this last area is done in two parts, one rather quiet of discovery, the second more dynamic, thus requiring to confront waves of enemies, how original, and finally brings us to the boss. There is no surprise in the progression, it is identical in each dungeon, but this is not a problem because there are only three dungeons, so a break in the game's rhythm is not completely necessary. The dungeon's difficulty evolve anyway, and most of all, they are extremely well differentiated and characterized. I will develop this later. And after all, there is a short break, a moment for us to catch our breath between waves of enemies. The area just before Castle Lockstone, the Stranded Sailor, is only a small transition before the dungeon. The enemies are optional. Then, after triumphing a third time over Avarice, our friend the chest, we have to carry on the exploration of Castle Lockstone to activate the elevator that will take us to the old watchtowers. Usually, the rest of the dungeon is accessible directly once the new spell is acquired. Here we stay for a while, setting free the ghosts of the previous Lords of Doors. The level design is a bit labyrinthine. There is no map, and the level design is not purely linear. There are secrets that can be missed, otherwise the collectibles would make little sense. However, we are guided, if necessary, as for example in the Witch's Estate, where some colored tiles can reassure us, although they are not essential in the reading of said level design. However, the exploration, on the scale of the whole game, is not that linear. The order of the dungeons is fixed. We have to start with the Witch's Manor, then the Frog King's Mushroom Dungeon, to finish with the castle and the heights where Betty lives. In each dungeon, indeed, we get, after the fight against Avarice the Chest, the spell that would be essential to have access to the next dungeon. It is also the spell which allows us to reach the rest of the dungeon. After defeating Avarice, we therefore have two choices. Keep on exploring the dungeon, or go to the next area directly. This is what I did the first time, without really paying attention after getting the fire spell. I didn't explore the rest of the dungeon, ignoring the huge door open in front of me. I went back to the cemetery, and while exploring, I was able to activate the lovely monster, which allowed me to go to the next area, the overgrown ruins. This is allowed by two things. First of all, the bosses don't give us any upgrade. Only their souls. They don't have any particular power that we could get back, their only problem is to accept their mortality, and their souls are only needed at the end of the game. The second element that allows this flexibility are the doors that link us to the hub, the Hall of Doors, by allowing us to go back to it. They act as a checkpoint. After each death, the game makes us start again at the last door we used, like a campfire or a bench. And of course, the enemies previously killed reappear as soon as we use a door. The interesting thing is that you activate several of them in each dungeon, one in each new area, and even one just before the boss. There are four per dungeon. This is a rather generous choice and layout, since you can, for example, fight all the bosses at the end if you want, after having completed all the dungeons, rather than doing everything in order. You can meanwhile improve all your stats before getting the giant souls, or start a dungeon and try another one if you get stuck. Each run is therefore very customizable. You also have a way out if the game is momentarily difficult for you, or if you are stuck in the exploration. The latter is rewarded by small collectibles, soul to improve our skills, and small objects, shiny things, souvenirs, almost totally useless except for three of them. After all, memories aren't always good for us if we believe Vaga the Free Crow, who quickly warns us and confides his secrets. Ain't no shinies, ain't no worries. In a game dealing with death, the non-playable characters are indeed often plunged into a loneliness and a sadness that will lead some of them to a certain excess, others to madness. Death is indeed not a happy prospect, and in Death Door it would seem that some are ready to do anything to stay alive, whatever the consequences on themselves and their loved ones could be. Bosses are not the characters we see the most. We learn more about them from their families or subordinates, as if they were already kind of dead and were spoken of as memories. The first two bosses, Grandma and the Frog King, appear sporadically inside the dungeon. They interrupt us for a few moments to threaten us. It's always more pleasant. Betty, on the other hand, is completely isolated in the heights, in her den. We learn all the less about her. The only link with the NPCs is her suitor, a slightly too drunk crow who sees her as a radiant beauty. Her roles are, at least. The reason for this loneliness is different for each boss. Following the death of her husband, Grandma locked herself in a quest for eternity, perhaps a way of denying what her husband went through, based on scientific research which drove her completely mad. The Frog King has decided to rule the forest, as show all the big nice statues of him all over the rooms. He is so determined that he sometimes crushes people under his bum, and we can assume that he was not ready for his reign to end. As for Betty, she is a yeti, a frightening beast. She is recluse in the heights of the world. But since we see very little of these characters, and given that the other NPCs are not necessarily more talkative or very little, we can use the places and the music to tell the story, and with regards to that, one of the characters has my preference. One boss has indeed lost her mind after living in her memories, is Grandma, the Urn Witch. This is the first dungeon that we have to explore, the Ceramic Manor, the Witch's Mansion. We start by progressing in the labyrinthine gardens where we meet Pothead, whose head has become a pot, following a failed experiment by the witch. Gardens with autumnal tones, but not entirely warm, where the water, calm, is of a light blue, almost white, very washed out, a color that's not vibrant. Gardens that are still well kept, the flowers haven't wilted, Pothead may have taken care of them, he has his own secret garden. Which doesn't prevent some of the statues from being on the ground and some of the bushes from turning slightly yellow, but that leads to secrets. Nobody has been picking up the dead leaves, the trees are bare, the railings are faded, it looks like there is moss. There are wooden planks on the ground, but the symmetry is intact. This symmetry is interesting. These are gardens that could be said to be French formal gardens, one of the characteristics of which is to be very symmetrical, a symmetry here clashed by the perspective almost isometric, which therefore does not render its size and previous grandeur, and as well and truly gone. A view from the front or from above would give a very different effect, much more spectacular. What once made the grandeur of this place, the symmetry, is no longer accessible to us, as if it didn't matter anymore. Only the exploration is still symmetrical, since, in a rather classical and logical way, we have to light two lanterns on both sides of the main path to finally reach the manor itself. The interior of the manor, also symmetrical in its exploration, reflects the same image. The marble floor is sometimes clean, like a mirror, reflecting a double of the room and of ourselves, sometimes dirty, just like the rooms, some rigorously arranged, order, others abandoned. This obsession with a double can find its origin in the witch's story. If she wishes so much to escape death by remaining immortal, this is because she mourns the passing of her husband. The symmetry of the manor and its gardens is always nuanced, clashed, as the double of the witch, her husband, has been taken away. There is now only one gigantic armchair in front of the hearth, and the double bed has only one pillow. But Crema doesn't sleep in the middle of the bed. She leaves the place free for her husband, as if he was still sleeping in the bed. Once again, the symmetry is broken. Like the half-kept, half-neglected garden, the mansion shows this ambivalent state. To the clear symmetry of the puzzles and the place, reinforced by the lines on the floor that give structure to the rooms, answers the state of neglect of too empty a house. The more we progress during the exploration, the more the rooms show signs of decay. It is dirty and tidy. A big chandelier is on the floor in the bedroom. Again, the symmetry is broken since there are two of them, one hanging from the ceiling, the other on the floor. And the more it goes, the more we explore basic structures, even old laboratories, to finally enter the basement, Grandma's huge furnace. From gardens that could act as a kind of facade, admittedly partially neglected, we explore the house and its somewhat disturbing corners and end up in Grandma's actual lair. Devastated by the death of her husband, Grandma decided to become immortal and started experimenting on just about everything she had at hand, including her grandson, Pothead. She's a character we hardly meet like the other bosses. After each soul is freed, the little birds, she comes, feigning to be angered by the mess we caused in her house and worries that a crow will break her immortality deal, then disappears in a cloud of purple smoke, literally. We see her only briefly afterwards in her laboratory, then the boss room. So we learn her story indirectly thanks to the charming Pothead and through the clues in the scenery. True to her name, the Witch of Urns has left many cages and jars of formaldehyde in her mansion. Were the birds, whose soul we set free, locked up? The manor is filled with urns, which are supposed to grant immortality, from which come out shapeless characters or small souls that escape by making a strange cry. And sometimes the experiment goes wrong and you get a boss. A waltzing boss, if you please. In addition to building a very nice level design, David Fenn composed the soundtrack to Death Door. In the estate of the Urn Witch, silence is followed by a long and beautiful melody. Until now, the music used the main motif, a very interesting one because it is based on a rather large interval, a fifth, treated in a symmetrical way, descending, then ascending, thus lending itself to both very dynamic and more solemn themes because of the time needed to pronounce it. We can hear it well in the music from The Lost Cemetery. On the flute, even more so on the alto flute, it takes a little time for the interval to sound clean. The embouchure technique requires a micro change of position. The theme of the gardens is much more vocal, made of stepwise motions, opening through larger intervals and tinged with a warm but sometimes tense color due to the choice of the alto flute. The register used does not, however, require an alto flute, but of course the sound is fuller. The vibrato makes this particular tone clearly heard and experienced flutists will definitely notice the changes in the fingerings. an element specific to the artistic direction of Death Door that I will develop in the last part of this video, and that the music in particular exposes in a very brilliant way, is the mix of many different genres. The Ripping Commission headquarters, showing a film noir ambience, are then replaced by a nature that looks at first a bit dull. The color palette from the Lost Cemetery is nicely done to show that this is a forgotten place, and then more colorful and warmer in the overgrown ruins, for instance. The music will continuously succeed in mixing the dynamism of the fight with the melancholy of the characters, their humor too as a politeness not to show too profound a despair in a setting often highlighting nature. We go from one to the other in an instant without the slightest effort. It's really seamless. It's a truly remarkable work of composition from David Fenn. The music is a beautiful example of elegy. It's a particular genre in lyric poetry, a text, a poem, or more generally a work, as here a music, mourning the death of a beloved one. The witch is indeed crying over her husband. David Fenn shows his talent as a melodist, and if this theme does not stray far from the elegiac register, he maintains the tension just before the transition with the oboe, whose lament is then very well directed by the phrasing of this very long note and by the 16th notes that allow the melody to keep its tension. It is very well balanced, since there are still large breaths between two repetitions of the melodic motif with a very light counterpoint, a short stepwise motion always plenty. The last note of the alto flute brings back this particular tone, a little breathy but very intense here. When the theme comes back, the counterpoint is enriched with the choir, the horn, and a more important support of the strings, and reminds us of combat by the addition of percussion. Small detail, we mainly find the enemies from the Lost Cemetery. There are relatively few different enemies in the game, but it is rather small, so this is not an issue. And among those, I find that the mages have a circular movement that flows just as much as the music. But Head offers a little breathing room and already shows his two sides. Seemingly comical with his pot head, he takes some time to tell us about the witch before heading back to guard the mansion's door. He too has regrets. He was rather handsome. I imagine that anyone would regret having a pot as a head. This melancholy, which is easily asserted in the gardens, fades a little when we arrive in the manor. Already the key changes, we were in A minor, no sharps, no flats, now we are in C minor, 3 flats. We feel, maybe, a little bit more locked in, but it's subjective and the sensations related to the different keys are very much context sensitive. We are inside, where the absence of the witch's husband is most visible, where the burden of the lost double, through the reflection on the marble, for example, is strongest. The piano returns, but the thematic elements are less direct in the image of this dead companion. They are rather arpeggios, where some notes sketch a melody which settles only afterwards, often through another instrument. Sometimes it even sounds as if something is missing from these arpeggios, as if there was only half of the music left, perhaps because it sounds very suspended, perhaps also because the melody is often completed a little between the notes by the other instruments. The register of the instruments is lower. Here the alto flute is used in the lower register, unlike the music from the gardens. In a very logical way, it sounds more intimate. This is no longer the elegy of the gardens, where the suffering was more openly expressed. Inside, in the mansion where Grandma lives, it is more discreet. It is as if in this place, bearing the traces of the death of the witch's husband, one had to come to terms with his absence, and the music therefore became somehow incomplete. There's no choice. As the witch bursts in, there's a new contrast with a different key, C-sharp minor instead of C minor, and the vindictive character of those interruptions, those are thinly veiled threats. The two themes, the melody from the gardens and the arpeggios from the manor, overlap. After the fight against Avarice, we can access the furnace. Again, the music is in two parts, as in all the biomes. The first, during an exploration without much difficulty in the furnace observation rooms, reinforces the mystery that this strange place and underground laboratory can arouse. The second one makes a nice mix between diegetic and non-diegetic elements, as the platforms from the inner furnace move in rhythm with the music. But the highlight is Grandma's final show of strength. The garden theme makes its grand return in the same time signature, 5-8. David Fenn's score regularly uses complex time signatures, 5-8 and 7-8 in particular, in a very natural way. If it was not very audible in the gardens of the manor, the melody developed naturally within the time signature. Here it sounds like a kind of waltz, slightly limping yet almost joyful, accentuated by the circular patterns and the equally circular dress of this witch. It must be said that Grandma defends herself, first by throwing urns in our face, true to one of her many nicknames, then by hiding in her favorite urn, its means of transportation like any other after all, and bombarding us with projectiles. The theme of Grandma is led by the violin and the piano, supported by an effective rhythm section, before the clarinet comes to impose its own material. The use of glissandos in the violin and clarinet gives a lot of freedom to the phrasing of the themes. After all, the witch is defending herself. It sounds as if the music were treated not from the point of view of the fighting crow, but from the point of view of Grandma, who wants to stay alive more than anything and, at the same time, wishes to protect her secrets. Just like a ruthless grandma who throws urn after urn, fireball after fireball, the music does not provide us any respite. It's not strictly speaking a rondo form where a refrain regularly alternates with episodes, but there is a certain regularity in the return of the main theme on the violin. One last hit, and it's time for Grandma's tribute. It is indeed without much surprise that Death Door evokes death, as a buzz driven by Charon, a classic, Charon, you see, brings us to the Reaper Commission headquarters, in an atmosphere worthy of the film noir genre, a black and white just illuminated by the playable crow's shiny weapons and the neglected objects, the small souvenirs left behind by all those souls. The colour palette will, however, evolve in a graveyard still a bit dull, mixing green and grey, to then open up with the dungeons, especially the first two. But it is indeed under a bureaucratic aspect that death is first shown, with offices, employees, procedures and forms. That's something fairly usual, actually it's even a trope. There's a list, not just anyone gets ripped. This is a way of turning it down by making death follow rules, a way of personifying it and thus almost humanizing it, since the other crows who work there have human reactions, albeit archetypal for comedy purposes, with Agatha, for example, the typist who is crazy about forms and typing. Later, when we meet him, death is depicted like a teenager wearing a fanny pack. It's practical, but no longer fashionable. This wish to tone down death can even be found in the gameplay, since although it is shown in a very dramatic way when it comes to our own death, a nod to Souls games, it is not very punishing. You don't lose any collectible, any soul. There are no echoes to recover where you died. You simply return to the last door you went through. The game, therefore, requires stamina in combat, but once again remains quite generous. A little crow is certainly mortal as long as the soul assigned to him has not been recovered, but he is a reaper most of all. It is a coherent choice. This doesn't completely isolate him from the headquarters where the small collectibles end up, for example. I think that having him go and get his souls back where he died, like in any Souls, Hollow Knight, Tunic, Blasphemous or Dandara, would individualize this character a bit too much, even though he's well characterized, but is more of a foil for other NPCs and it would probably distance him too much from the headquarters. Tunic's little vixen, on the other hand, is completely alone, abandoned to her riddles on a sandbank in the middle of nowhere. She can only rely on herself when it comes to recovering her own echo. But if we try so hard to tame this death, this is because it is often there, it does not hide, in the bloodstains on the ground, almost bright, in the corpses that sometimes disappear and sometimes accumulate like a mass grave, willingly reminiscent of the ragdoll feel from the soul's corpses, sometimes with small disturbing or amusing, depending on the scene, details such as the eyes that come off the shells. The humanity of the characters, the fact that they are living beings, is hidden, blurred. Grandma is completely altered by her experiments, Cook Jefferson is only a corpse, gruesome puppet operated by a somewhat relatively charming squid, and many mobs are masked. The imagery of death is found in the graphics, such as the witch's urns, objects traditionally associated with death through funeral urns. As for the partially buried anchors that allow us to use the grappling hook, they look like ankhs, symbol of life. We also see the skeletons of the birds who soar with free in each dungeon. Those are quite realistic skeletons, as in Betty's arena, and sometimes found in a specific posture, laying on the ground like a recumbent statue. It is also a question of context. When these little souls are freed, systematically they utter a few words evoking their regret over the past, over their death. Still don't care much for them. It doesn't feel fair to me. It might be a bit late, given that I am deceased. There is a combination of innocence and tragedy that can make those statements serious, despite the tone and the style used. In comparison, in Cult of the Lamb, the skeletons, the enemy's corpses, have a more cartoonish look, and most of all, the rage of the little lamb when they fight removes any melancholy that could be found in this image. In this roguelite, one does not mourn the dead. In Death Door, on the contrary, the matter of death being quite dominant, even central, there's respect for the dead. In The Lost Cemetery, we quickly meet Steadhone, whose eyes in the shape of an emote seem to be perpetually crying, like Betty, who seems to have tears under her eyes. After each boss has been killed, including the last Lord of Doors, Steadhone gives a short speech in their memory, in front of their dead body respectfully placed on the ground, or in their favorite urn, supporting his words with limited gestures that nevertheless translate the respect he has for the dead and for his function. Insensitive to blows, he is not insensitive to pain, having also lost a friend. When his boss card appears on the screen, the way the word is cut makes grave stand out. He probably had to dig his own dog's grave. Death is not the only imagery, however. As a counterpart to this presence of death almost everywhere, the game celebrates life through nature, which is very present from the first zone, the Grove of Spirits, a tutorial confronting us with a demonic forest spirit adapted from the previous game, Titan Souls, although largely modified. This short zone sets the tone for the rest of the game. The crow will travel through a rather natural world, even in the less wild areas. The gardens of the witch's estate give pride of place to plants, and the mansion's basement is like a mine that would have been turned into a huge laboratory. Castle Lockstone has been abandoned to snow and ice. And the music, of course, is going to emphasize this nature by an intense use of the woodwinds, as well as some very specific instrumental techniques. In particular, the woodwinds used are uneven. Indeed, for some instruments, the tone and the pitch of the notes are more variable than for others. Take a piano. Play a chromatic scale on the whole keyboard. If the piano is in good condition, you should not hear a drastic change in tone from one note to the next. The tone will change, of course, but not abruptly. It is an even instrument. Concerning the transverse flute, made of metal, the bum flute, if it can be considered relatively even, its predecessor, the traverso, made of wood, is very uneven. Some specific fingerings, the fork fingerings, when alternating a closed hole, an open hole and a closed hole, make the sound hollower, from one note to the next one, and being constantly in tune is therefore more difficult. It also depends on the model of the traverso you're playing. Some are more difficult than others. If the B sounds good, C is a different matter. The same for the low D, it's nice and full, but the low E, too bad. It's like that, it's an uneven instrument like many wooden instruments. One can hear a little of this unevenness of the instruments, especially the pitch is cleverly used, with a portamento sometimes so that the note is very tense and a little sharp. It is very appropriate and reinforces the really lyrical character of this musical theme. The choice of the flattertzunge too, or flattertonguing, you roll the tip of the tongue rapidly or use your throat to make a rolling sound. The boss's patterns are also very organic. At some point, you can almost see her dancing when she chases you while spinning, or when her arms wave during her slow circular pattern, and I particularly like that moment when she loses her balance. This responds very well to the mix of all the woodwinds in her theme, which have all the more freedom in their interventions and pitch, as the bass of the piece is extremely tight rhythmically. The piano and the strings are relentless, foreshadowing the main aspect of the game, fight. In my analysis of the Hollow Knight soundtrack, I had explained that sometimes in an ensemble, you may want a pyramidal distribution of the different sounds, that is to say that some of the instruments will play with a beautiful sound and others less so in order to keep the clarity of the counterpoint. Here it is the same idea but for the phrasing. The piano and the strings have a very tight phrasing, no freedom is allowed, which allows the woodwinds to have a more organic phrasing and that the whole score remains perfectly clear. This nature can embody a form of organic disorder compared to the strictness, quite relative, of the Ripping Commission headquarters, like the small spirits which come wandering there and end up covered with ink for one of them, which get in line and follow us but fear our sword. Nature can also bring us back to our own mortality by its cyclical aspect that we temporarily follow. It will be there after our death, like the healing flowers, they bloom again after each game over. However, it is not a vibrant tribute to nature as in Kena Bridge of Spirits, which also features a playable character guiding the dead in a beautiful forest, coming back to life with each defeated boss. Death Door is more modest in its representation of nature. It is sometimes raw, sometimes tamed, I mean constructed, even in the forest, but the game skillfully mixes the two. It is never really either or. Under the mansion, there is a cave. In the forest, there is a dungeon. In the castle, there is snow. The color palettes remain soft, sometimes warm, as in the forest, which reminds the warmth of a nice summer, unlike the more autumnal colors of the gardens of the witch's manor. In the last part of the game, some touches of red come to warm up a little the icy atmosphere of the place, and the music especially brings a lot of warmth, of tenderness even, with the guitar and the alto flute very often used, or the recorder whose melody sounds like a little soul lost in the middle of Castle Lockstone. The Stranded Sailor is soothing with its soft guitar accompanied by the piano, with a nice effect when the music changes from non-diegetic to diegetic when we enter the small restaurant. Nature is important to the point of having a voice, a soul. It sealed the doors of the mushroom dungeon when it understood that the Frog King was a danger to the forest children. The forest mother must therefore speak to it by playing her horn again. The solo becomes a duet. One feels protected in this forest, sheltered by the shade of the trees. Indeed, if the fight gets spectacular very quickly, considering the number of enemies involved or the patterns of the bosses, who are significantly bigger than the Reaper, by the constant projectiles for Grandma or her vivacity in the case of Betty the Yeti, nature itself is not really aggressive. Fire is not dangerous, it is a camp, restaurant or something that will open a hidden path. That's why the animation of the burning structures is rather slow. Besides being consistent with the music, it shows that these objects won't hurt us. We can even find this opposition between life and death in the structure of the game. There is something after the end, the exploration is not over yet, and we can enjoy the areas under another light, that of the moon, which will accompany us for some lighter puzzles. The music also shifts to its softer side, more dreamlike, up to the collectible fanfare, now hushed. The game doesn't give up completely, though, as it's not pure exploration. We still have things to do, even if it's simpler, more scattered, like the small gestures in the music that feel closer, some pizzicatos, soft piano notes, the beginning of the leitmotif, that again warm up the oneric string layers. And the humor is never far away, thanks to the squid that has us walk across the map to a gigantic statue, under the light of the moon that is now to be found on those translucent tiles. Note that you can fight the gravedigger with a squid on your back. But you can also find yourself face to face with an owl, and I like owls. The game has two sides, like many of its characters. You can be alive but dead, like the cook, friend or foe, like Stedhorn, who attacks you in a last fight, or Pothead, who reveals his connection with Grandma only after a few encounters and who oscillates, as we saw earlier, between the humor related to his appearance and the distress between the lines of not having a head anymore and knowing his grandmother's distress. In Death Door, we go from one emotion to another in an instant. There is probably a reason why the artistic direction of Death Door seems to me so successful. It is the way it effortlessly mixes many different genres. If we look at the enemies, we have a rather heterogeneous bestiary. We have basic enemies, harmless animals or plants, others more humanized, whether they roll towards us or jump on us, those wear a mask in relation to the current area. And then the usual categories, archers, wizards, knights, with for each one different variants, especially the knights, quite varied in their appearance and especially their size. Some are more unique, like the boomerang mobs or in particular the plague boys that can be found almost exclusively in Grandma's inner furnace. They look like birds and fit well with the witch's slightly confusing experiments. We even have a chest, Avarice, post from Titan Souls, that seems to come out of nowhere, but we find the familiar enemies inside that thing. These enemies are varied, but there are relatively few compared to the quantity we have to face, and their management is sometimes surprising in the sense that a variant will appear late, or a specific enemy like the Plague Doctor is found in an area in particular and then disappears before reappearing right at the end. It doesn't really matter, though they are more like henchmen endlessly summoned to impede our quest for giant souls. Besides, despite this varied aspect, they are stylistically consistent, as are the graphics on the scale of the whole game. Everything is perfectly mastered, especially the wind, fire and smoke effects, simple but perfectly integrated. The universe seems simple, but it is very well made. However, it is undoubtedly in the music that this mix of different genres is the most successful. There are indeed several categories of sound and thematic elements, all very specific to the style of the composer, David Fenn, but their combination has been pushed to the extreme in this remarkable score, the game focusing on rather opposite imageries. The first one refers to the bureaucratic aspect of the Hall of Doors, what happens inside, shall we say, in the headquarters or in the Lord of Doors Cathedral, which is embodied by the piano, that would be a kind of sound reference. The gameplay is focused on combat, recurrent since the waves of enemies just keep coming, and dynamic given that it requires hand-to-hand combat to recover magic points, so the music will have more epic movements using two elements, the orchestra reinforced by the choir, and the electric guitar. Finally, nature, which is on the other side of the doors, is carried by wind instruments, the woodwinds, some percussion, and often pizzicato strings. Of course, it would be a bit too simple to strictly follow this division, and in reality, the music will constantly move from one of these elements to the other, which is heard from the first zone, the Ripping Commission headquarters and its Hall of Doors. We discover them at the same time as the Little Reaper. A priory a little cold, modern and relatively empty, containing a modest noodle bar, a broken fountain, filled with garbage and surrounded by barbed wire, they turn out to be very slightly Art Nouveau in style, including platforms with organic shapes, a huge filing cabinet, or filing wall rather, some pretty street lamps and elegant elevators with visible counterweights. A few lights, the neon and the crow's weapon, break the color palette that's mostly in shades of grey, but one can find some depth to it. It could be compared to recent roguelite Have a Nice Death, in which we embody death itself, a reaper who can't take any more of this routine where the visible boredom, rather the imminent burnout of death, is underlined rather by shades of brown in the trailer's introduction and then a grey-blue tone in the gameplay, compensated by much more colourful and spectacular effects when they go to remind their scourgers that maybe they shouldn't be that involved. The Hall of Doors at the Reaper Commission headquarters is more reminiscent of a film noir atmosphere also present in the music. The piano is the main instrument supported by pizzicato strings. Some musical gesture already announce, although still discreetly, the themes of the game. Light strings and a soft harp tremolo open the game in a rather oniric atmosphere that the piano immediately makes more concrete yet relaxed. And then there's the rhythm. For now, it's rather classic, even if one can hear it playing with the division of the bar. The atmosphere changes when the counterpoint is enriched. The clarinet, joined by the strings, comes to dress the piano line, which then states the leitmotif. The combination is very moving, the clarinet in particular. It sounds less relaxed, just a bit more lyrical. The conclusion of this part is interrupted by small percussion tremolos, marimba, but there are other instruments in the background, and harp tremolos. The attacks are mixed before the clarinet comes back to discreetly complete the counterpoint. The musical elements related to nature are shy, but they are heard. The Hall of Doors is not completely sealed and nature tight. All the contrasting elements are therefore recognizable from the first zone. To the lack of brilliance of the offices, a codified and unoriginal workplace for characters locked in an endless cycle, will respond the unique mission of the four-tailed crow, walking through a nature whose warmth we can guess but where death has disappeared, and where he will be confronted with ever more epic trials, and that paradoxically he will bring back to life by allowing death to be part of it again. Thereafter, we will always find this beautiful combination, this versatility. Even in the most natural places, such as the overgrown ruins, we will find the piano accompanied by a more solemn choir, and then, as expected, tangible and amusing elements with the pizzicato strings, percussion and recorder. On the other hand, the intense moments will always maintain a strong connection with nature, as for example the omnipresence of the flute in the icy heights of the last zone, or even in the last challenge of the Lord of Doors. As Death Door puts the emphasis on combat, the gameplay quickly becomes dynamic, especially since, even though magic is powerful, hand-to-hand combat proves to be very effective as it allows you to chain hits very quickly, as soon as you have increased your dexterity and understood the patterns. The first enemies are quickly defeated, the mages are stunned from the first blow, which allows you to hit a few times without worry, and even the powerful knights can be eliminated fairly quickly without using any spell. During the beat-them-all phases, the mix between mobs, their projectiles and the potential AoE of their spell leads to a particularly lively rhythm, and it is even very exhilarating to manage to dodge everything to triumph over these waves of enemies. This dynamism contrasts with the apparent stillness of places that often we seem to be disturbing. The Reaper has a purpose, which forces us to use a weapon, but the places being often warm, peaceful, the second one especially, and the characters, although locked in, seem to be as well. No NPC except enemies or bosses is an antagonist, all are friendly. It gives the impression that we're disturbing those places a bit. In the graphics, this translates into several parameters. The game being in 3D, all the elements are modeled, with here the choice of a certain roundness in the graphic style. The few animation elements are rather slow. This is sometimes informative, like the mushrooms that move slightly. Hitting them reloads our spell bar. Their animation makes them stand out from the other elements of the landscape we can't interact with. But generally, those are rather calm animations. All the fire structures have a slow animation, whether it is the smoke, the flames, or the movement of the structure when it opens. It is the same for the dust under our hero's feet, as well as the feathers that slowly escape with each roll. For the elements of the scenery that reappear, the ice crystals, for example, or others that simply move with the wind. The wind is often suggested by very thin lines, quietly animated, just like the sea at the end of the Lost Cemetery. Even the charming dragon, monster, whatever, that brings us to the overgrown ruins is rather quiet, as opposed to a stag bursting from a cloud of dust, ready to take us to the desired station. In Death Door, the places we explore have been granted to elude death. They are wrapped in a soft torpor. The color palettes, from the most neutral to the warmest, have in common a form of restraint, except for the elements directly or indirectly related to soul, the small masses of soul energy, the keys and locks, the little souls stuck in the witch's urns, the animations when shortcuts appear or disappear, the reaper's weapons and spells. All the chosen colors show a certain softness, whether it is related to the function of a place, the Lost Cemetery, or its natural character. This is also true for the light, natural, sometimes even indirect, always soft, even in Grandma's mansion. Finally, the instrumentation often uses the guitar, the alto flute, with a warmer sound, less brilliant than the sound of the standard flute, and the brass instruments are used with softness, softness highlighted with smaller, more concrete gestures like the pizzicatos and the percussion in the overgrown ruins. But the little reaper comes to disturb the peacefulness of these islands, showing up with his weapons and his mission, most certainly in spite of himself. The music has two faces. In the dungeons, there is always a calm music and a more dynamic one. It can be a simple layer added to the bass theme, a complexification of the music as in Grandma's Gardens, when the theme is taken up with more instruments, or a music specific to the fights, as in the overgrown ruins. The music is more lyrical, elegiac in Grandma's Aria, as I said earlier, as she faces the grief of her husband's death. In the other Arias, it is rather the strange sleep of this deathless nature that seems to be evoked. Especially in the second part of each dungeon, after the fight against Avarice, this one being divided again in two parts, an exploration without much danger and then a more complex part with waves of enemies, the music also follows this evolution with a calm music that logically gets more intense. We can even find an evolution on the scale of the whole game. The last part of the last dungeon easily evokes a certain urgency. We are one door away from the last boss. In order for the two themes not to be in a mere confrontation but organically connected, the same sound elements will contribute to both atmospheres. Each element of instrumentation has therefore often two faces. To the intimate alto flute responds the woodwinds and their sometimes more specific techniques. The guitar is acoustic and then electric. The percussion goes from small amusing gestures to an unfailing support of combat, just like the piano, translating the apparent collectedness of the Lord of Doors as well as the unrelenting attacks of the demonic forest spirits. And most of all, tooling all these elements, there is the choir that can be heard in almost every piece. In the calmest sections of exploration, it is a beautiful coloration which turns into a spectacular support of the little crow in the combat sequences, especially the confrontations against Avarice the Hungry Chest. The Silent Servants are a good example of this. There are four similar mini-bosses, each upgrading one of our spells. They can be seen guarding the entrance to the room where the Lord of Dawn lives, with a steaming cauldron for a head. Thank you. It's surprising to hear the theme played on the flute. Boss or mini-boss themes on the flute are not common, even less so if you add a bass clarinet counterpoint to the equation. Honestly, it's beautiful. In the first part, I hear 3/8, although one could also analyze most of the instruments in a simple time. The measure accentuates the melancholy of their theme because the strong and weak beats are treated in a very classical way. Only the first beat is accentuated as in waltz, but it is not quite the same effect as in Shall We Dance? For example, the theme of the Broken Vessel from Hollow Knight has a particular use of accents because, although it is in 3/4, it's the second beat which is accentuated for the accompaniment, giving a somewhat strange, limping character to the theme of this vessel artificially brought back to life by seeds of infection. It's a much more natural flow, the bar for the Silent Servants, reinforced by the pizzicatos on the first two beats, a very classical accompaniment again with later harp arpeggios and generally the balance between the flute and string playing in unison. It's a combination I particularly like, and as I mentioned before, the counterpoint on the bass clarinet. Although apparently rather calm, some details of the phrasing can betray a certain urgency. Some notes of the flute are notably supported thanks to the vibrato, a little faster on several notes, which makes them slightly higher and more tense, a little like in the Demonic Forest Spirit, but the effect used is different and the result is less intense, which is to be expected because the musical context is different. These are nice details of phrasing. Very cleverly, the sound design, unlike the music, was made very spectacular because the boss's patterns are, especially when their fork vibrates like a tuning fork and immobilizes us, or the hellish grappling hook of the associated servant. The second part of the loop is therefore more discreet, with simple arpeggios before the return of a more melodic flute. We recognize the leitmotif, of course, as well as some effects, here the flutter tonguing, that we find in all of Death Door's soundtrack. Working at the Ripping Commission means being in touch with a specific kind of bureaucracy which sometimes takes the form of a rather solemn meeting. The Lord of Doors embodies this part of the game. They're an imposing character that we meet after beating the first boss. The little crow brings them the giant soul he's just defeated. We find the color palette from the Hall of Doors, but the setting has a more religious dimension. We see a small building that reminds me of a confessional, partially destroyed arches and most of all windows, and a rose window. We are in a church, and it's not the music that's going to prove us wrong. The meeting itself is unusual. The piano takes up the leitmotif in a rhythmically very relaxed version. Melodically, we find a characteristic element of David Fenn's music, fast-paced notes in chromatic motion, used here to create a distance with a more formal introduction and to translate the phlegmatic attitude of the Lord, amplified by the compound meter and the quaternary triplets. Alone in this strange room that definitely looks like a fragmented cathedral, the Lord of Doors, surrounded by very basic furniture, quenches their thirst and gives us a large greeting gesture with their mug, World's Best Lord. They're obviously portrayed in a humorous light. Uncomfortable in our presence, they first congratulate us for still having a beak, and then makes fun of our presence here. They applaud the crow that has come, proudly, to bring his first giant soul, so much so that sparks fly from their hands, reminding us that they're all in metal, as confirmed by their sound design and the iridescent reflections of their armor? Costume? Suit? No matter. This is a great opportunity to torment again the Reaper, who is sent back to the headquarters without mercy. But in a final about-face, the Lord of Doors reveals a deep malaise and sighs as they are staring at Death's Door at the far end of the Lost Cemetery. During the final battle against him, the elements are similar. During the platforming phases, he taunts us, summoning lion gates, apparently there are such things, and then confronts us in the various areas we previously explored, the manor's gardens, the overgrown ruins, and Betty's lair, before moving on to a final battle in the Hall of Doors, which is essentially centered on the electric guitar. Death's Door manages to maintain a balance between humor and melancholy. It is thus very often a humor which is there precisely to mask painful feelings, even unspeakable secrets. The characters are certainly presented in a humorous way, physically, verbally, their names sometimes describing their burden, or through their gestures, in particular put head, but they are not necessarily funny voluntarily. They often express a slightly veiled sadness, like Stedhone, who is insensitive to blows and yet seems to be wishing to die, the loss of a head or a husband for the witch, or even a brother for the forest children. And all those frail dead birds in the dungeons. Their dialogues are amusing, without them really meaning too. In the case of the playable character, humor is translated by his reactions. He doesn't speak, doesn't have a name, humor can only be nonverbal. But what characterizes him is his mission. We don't perceive any melancholy in his case. He only fights, and often these confrontations will take place over music that doesn't aim at being particularly funny, but will rather take up this idea of solemnity. The fight against Avarice had this mix of humor and grandeur that makes the artistic direction of Death's Door so successful despite this varied character. The Little Reaper finds himself face to face with a chest that chews him without mercy. The sound design is absolutely cartoonish, with, in particular, a falling sound like in a Roadrunner and Wile E. Coyote episode, and after that starts the most epic music, taking up the theme of that very same Avarice from Titan Souls, where the orchestra, the choir, and the electric guitar will all blend. It's a theme crammed with energy in 7-8, where two parts will oppose each other. The first one is essentially descending. Each bar consists in a descending arpeggio on the first 5 beats, followed by a small stepwise motion on the last 2 beats. It is quite unbalanced, 5 against 2, but there is always a strong energy boost at the end of the bar through the contrast with the beginning of the bar, descending and in decrescendo, and the instrumentation, of course. Each new bar is brought with force like a cycle, starting back again and again with always as much energy. The second part, on the contrary, is based on ascending arpeggios, supported by the choir's interventions, which will give a truly grandiose dimension to this confusing fight against enemies with an unusual design, and a sound design that is sometimes just as strange. At this point, the tension does not decrease anymore, there is no more really descending motion to compensate, not as much as in the first part anyway, and the very nervous phrasing of the repeated notes at the end of the bar, the division is always 5 plus 2, creates always more energy. The guitar then restates the thematic elements from the first part with a more assertive phrasing and a constant energy, thanks to a few variations in the articulation and through more dynamic intervals, notably the augmented second. But that's to be expected. When you talk about death, after a while you don't laugh anymore. When the Grey Crow learns about death itself, he loses his mind, and that time he's not made fun of. He has been assigned an impossible task, retrieving the soul of the mortal who opened the first door. The connection is made with Titan Souls, since this human is the playable character from Titan Souls. After defeating the Titans one by one, they had opened the first door. Behind this gate was Truth, which they had confronted, merging with it and thus gaining the knowledge of all things at all times. Escaping Truth and returning to the human world, they had, however, lost their soul, leaving a body without a soul, and a soul without a body. A soul without a body cannot exist, it dissolves in the ether, participating in the endless cycle of souls. The soul of the human was thus well and truly lost, dissipated in the ether. At the same time, the first door had been destroyed. The last Lord of Doors recovered the essence of this door to carry out their plan for immortality. Long before, another Lord had indeed presented themselves to death, offering to collect souls through doors in exchange for a slightly longer life, thus relieving death of the lamentations of the loved ones of those whose soul he was reaping. A longer life, but not an eternal life, that is impossible or else you'd become a demon. Each Lord of Doors, created and appointed by their predecessor, knew, from the moment of their creation, the day of their own death. But one of them refused to die. Destroying the current death door, using the essence of the first door to build a new one and attract death, they locked death behind it, in the ether, sealing death door forever. A world without death to fulfill their insane wish for eternity. To do this, they had to keep the Reaper, the Grey Crow, away, assigning him the soul of the mortal who opened the first door. But that soul, remember, was already gone. He did not know. He, who was immortal as a Reaper, saw his own immortality and the way he could live it, sacrificed at the cost of that of the last Lord of Doors, the last to succumb to the madness that has taken hold of almost every character in this story. Faced with the realization that his assigned soul is now lost forever, along with his immortality, the Grey Crow loses his mind and attacks the Little Reaper. Following the aesthetics of the last fight in Titan Souls, the fight against Truth, the confrontation takes place there in the ether itself, behind Death Door. A serious fight, in a white place without apparent volume. The music leaves almost all the elements that we heard until then, even leaves the elements from Titan Souls' Truth boss, rather focused on the strange nature of this last Titan, to keep only a lyrical piano playing a series of arpeggios in which we can eventually find the leitmotif, hardly. There is indeed no more nuance, neither in the graphics, in an almost pure black and white, if we accept some grey tiles on the ground, in the distress of the Grey Crow, which translates into a return to his animality, whereas all the crows are since the beginning anthropomorphized. He does not speak anymore, he cries. He does not reason anymore, he attacks. But if I had to keep only one example of the mix of genres in Death Door, more particularly in its music, that would be the theme of Betty the Yeti, because all the aforementioned elements are going to be connected with just what's needed to make the balance absolutely perfect. As a character, we know that Betty is a Yeti. A few skeletons in her lair, a desperate suitor, not much else. As a boss, she's magnificent. I say she's the fastest boss in the game. The fight against the Lord of Doors relies more on stamina, but the overall difficulty of the game is moderate. Alternating brief but vigorous pawing, deadly rolls, she adjusts her position if you dodge too soon, and avalanches of snowballs. The introduction is made of small gestures with percussion and strings, systematically treated with effects, tremolos or pizzicatos, the latter responding well to the attacks of the percussion by this tangible effect, while the tremolos, an effect here more spectacular by its speed, remind us that, after all, there's a boss fight coming up. The funny thing is that in my attempts during the introduction, Betty was only doing patterns related to the music, only her swift paw attacks with or without jumping. The rolls, a longer pattern working by three, only came afterwards when the arpeggios began. It is very lively, it's a small, simple motif in arpeggios that sounds cyclical thanks to the measure, I hear it in 3/8. The rhythm, the first beat, is faster, and the broken movement of the arpeggios ascending at the end of the measure, allowing again for some renewed energy, but here, even more than in Avarice, it gives the impression of an endless cycle, almost dancing, very natural. It is very light, especially since the instrumentation is very close to the introduction. Through the guitar, whose attack reminds us of pizzicatos, then a light counterpoint that will lead us to the next part. The orchestra is there from now on, but we should not forget that we are in the heights of Castle Lockstone. So we find the flute that we heard in the whole area, the castle and the old watchtowers with a different character. There's no melancholy here, it's a sharp confrontation between the Reaper and his victim. Sorry, Betty. The reminder of Betty's nimble patterns comes with the interventions of the orchestra in a rather amusing descending chromatic motion, contrasting with the fluidity of the flute theme, fluidity that is accentuated in the short transition where the leitmotif returns and the choir appears discreetly in an ascending motion, leading to the radiant entry of the bass. leitmotif is stated with emphasis at the beginning. As I said earlier, this is a motif that's immediately recognizable, which can be played and shaped in a very dynamic way, or with more languor. Here the rhythm makes it almost triumphant. A descending stepwise motion, still in the brass, allows us to move on to the choir, which takes up this element in mirror with a different phrasing, of course. The choir, doubled by the flute, supports, sings, I mean that the phrasing is more melodious. The brass, always more dynamic, states, impose themselves without ever crushing the rest of the ensemble. The interventions of the orchestra allow to close the loop since we find the percussion from the beginning, while the brass elegantly fade out thanks to a master diminuendo. Here we go again for another round. In just a little more than 1 minute, we have heard everything, all the musical elements, all the emotions of the game. It is varied without ever feeling abrupt, because we go from one episode to the other, through transitions, and especially, there is this guiding line which gives all the necessary fluidity to the music. Ah, Betty, I don't know if you were a radiant beauty, but one thing is sure, your theme is beautiful, and it is just as radiant. Thank you for watching this video. It's been 1 year now, and still not many people here, but you're here and that's what counts. Next month, I'm analyzing Journey. Boy, am I impatient to do this video. Okay, thanks again and goodbye!